I would like to give a historical background, rather go back in history in the post-independence era. I say that, well, from 1947 to 65 was the period of euphoria of independence. Everybody was expecting that now the Britishers have gone and our government has come, so all our problems will be solved by the independent government. So that was the euphoria of independence period. But then by mid-60s, disillusionment started. There was panchayat, there was five-year plans, and there was so-called land reforms, this, that, and the other. Many things came up. But ultimately, it didn't reach the poor and the working class, the unorganized working class. None of these benefits reached, including the small farmers. So you saw between 66 and 75, you saw many sections of society were affected by the same policies of the government. They started revolting. There were peasant revolts, the tribals revolt was there to a certain extent, which grew in 70s and 80s. Students were agitating. I was a student at that time. I was also part of this agitation. Women, you know, had started raising their voice. 1975 was declared as the year of women, and so on. And Dalits. Dalit poets started raising their voice first, and subsequently the Dalit Panther in Maharashtra, the Dalit Sangharsh Samiti in Karnataka, and so on. So all over India. So all these protests you see between 66 and 75. And last but not the least, the struggles were led by the working class. The workers were up in arms. There were so many strikes, including the historic railway strike, and so on and so forth. So that is the period of disillusionment and taking up the struggles on the road. What you see is, recognizing this, the government started its own strategy. And you see that between 76 and 90, which I call as the period of rise of the voluntary organizations. Many voluntary organizations came into being, and also environmental movement, environmental groups, environmental organizations. Also, the question of environment became very important. Especially in Karnataka, there were so many environmental movements taking place. Against Birla's in Harihar Polyfiber, against Karnataka Pulpwood Limited, which had taken away 75,000 acres of common land, against Kaiga, against so many dams and joining of rivers, and so on and so forth. So that is it. And also that was the period where non-party political formations, disillusioned with all the political parties, but recognizing the importance of politics. That was the period when I was also part of this kind of a non-party political formation at that time. So that is the general history till WTO, the World Trade Organization's regime, is established firmly in our country in the early 90s. After that, the voluntary organizations which had raised voice, which had taken up various issues like Panchayat Raj, like women's issues, like self-help groups, like environmental issues, and so on and so forth, education and health included, all these voluntary organizations got transformed into NGOs. If you call anybody now whom I refer still because of my old habit, so you are part of a voluntary organization. Yes, sir, I am part of an NGO. So, and then it's not only a change in the nomenclature, their whole nature, their whole method of working, their whole perspective, everything changed. Now they wanted to be part of the government. They would do what the government tells them to do. It could be education, it could be health, but they will be sort of less salary giving government servants. So non-government meaning what? They are responsible to nobody. government has certain rules and regulations. NGOs have no rules, regulations. So you come and go, nobody asks you. So irresponsible kind of a behavior. So that kind of a thing. And where there is money, these people will take up work. So this is the historical background of what happened. And what we see happening after the advent of globalization, liberalization, privatization, and the WTO regime is established, is voluntary organizations are no more. The left parties who were raising their voice also lost their voice in a significant manner, because wherever they are in power, they would follow the same WTO policies, the new economic policies, like invest Bengal and so on. The working class movement was down after the failure of the historic textile worker strike in Mumbai. So that was not there. The Dalit movement got divided umpteen number of times. So their voice also got less and less militant. So that was the kind of thing that was happening. And I, for one, when the working class was up in arms, I was part of the working class movement. I worked with the power loom workers in Belgaum. 15,000 workers we organized. And also Indian Aluminium Company workers led a historic 60-day struggle. So I was part of that. When the environmental movement became strong, we took up this issue, not for the sake of environment, not for the sake of environment, but for the sake of people. That, well, environment and working people have a very close biotic relationship. And so we said that if destruction of environment means destruction of livelihood support. So we took up environmental movement in that direction. Not save the white tiger or whatever, but save the people, save the tribals, save the farmers. So that kind of a thing. But then, as I said, when the NGOs, when the voluntary organizations became NGOs, there was question before me. What is my role now? What do I do now? The voluntary organizations also were finding a financial crunch, because funding agencies were moving away from South India to North India, saying that, well, now you are all developed. Karnataka is developed, so we don't have a role. So various reasons, and the others were co-opted by the government, state and the central government.